There's one thing about this Kavanaugh story that I don't think is getting any coverage at all. I mean, I think I'm the only person who has actually noticed this, at least that I've heard. And the reason it's not getting any coverage is because the left hates our president, Donald Trump, and people on the right, a lot of commentators on the right are also uncomfortable with the president and don't really have, I think, as clear a picture of who he is and what he does as they should. I've always criticized him when I thought he deserved criticism, and I've always praised him when I thought he deserved praise. But the one thing that I have noticed is how incredibly cool he is being in this Kavanaugh fight. I mean, he is sweatless. He is just, and look, let's face it, cool is not the word I would usually use to describe Donald Trump, right? Cool is, he's usually very hot-tempered. He usually is flying off the handle. He's got tweets going that maybe he shouldn't be doing. He is playing this Kavanaugh thing like he has got it sewed up. And the reason that's important is you cannot deny, whatever you think of Donald Trump, you cannot deny his fantastic political instincts. He knows what is going on with his base. He knows what's going on with the country. And he's got the press in his pocket. He has got them, he is bouncing them down the street like a basketball. No matter, every time they come at him, it's like you think it's, oh, this time they've got him. And then he's just like, you know, swish, they're gone. You know, it just makes them. So he gave a press conference, and we have to talk about this too. He goes out and gives a press conference, and what he wants to talk about is his new NAFTA deal. It's now, he has renegotiated NAFTA as he promised to do. And it's now called this something like the US-Mexico-Canada Agreement, USMCA or something like this. Now remember the panic and the hysteria from both right and left on this. The New York Times said this is bogus because he made the deal with Mexico and said, if Canada doesn't want to renegotiate, fine, I'll just redo it with Mexico. And everybody's going, oh, this is awful. This is, oh, the trade war, the death, the love, the economy, the crashing, the Wall Street Journal. I mean, people were actually popping out of the newspaper and weeping, just look at my tears, the trade, the free trade is gone. And suddenly, at the deadline, Canada says, we'd like to be part of NAFTA too, please. This is an incredible, incredible redemption of Donald Trump and the way. And, you know, Walter Russell Mead, who is one of the best columnists at the Wall Street Journal, he says, even the administration's fiercest critics are calling the revisions to NAFTA significant. The US-Mexico-Canada agreement requires that cars be made with 75% North American components to escape tariffs. 40% of each car must also be manufactured in facilities where workers earn $16 an hour or more on average. And crucially, Canada has also cracked open the door to its dairy markets for American farmers. So this is a big deal. And it has China worried, okay? And this is the thing. The big target here is China, because that's the big market that is treating us unfairly. And suddenly, the list of topics that China's censors want news sources to treat sensitively, because it's a censorship society, right, is a revealing one. Recent instructions tell editors in China to be careful with economic data that suggests China is being hurt by the trade war, that its economy is slowing, that local government debt is growing, or that consumer confidence is falling. That means all those things are happening in China, which is what somebody said would happen. Guess who? Donald Trump. Now, you remember that when this whole trade thing started, what I said was, I'm not going to call this because I think Trump is a good negotiator. A negotiation is emotion. A negotiation is movement from one place to another. And what the press does is take snapshots of each place that he is and gets hysterical about that place where Trump is thinking, no, I'm just trying to get to the end of this negotiation. Now, look, this thing can be voted down, especially if the GOP loses in the midterms. They can just throw this new agreement away. But it's obviously a good agreement. It obviously justifies Trump's strategies and his tactics. In fact, I think this calls for the Trump happiness montage. Let's hit it.
We're going to win so much. We're going to win at every level.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
We're going to win economically. We're going to win with the economy. We're going to win with military. We're going to win with health care and for our veterans. We're going to win with every single facet.
Zip-a-dee-dee-da, zip-a-dee-ay. My, oh, my. What a wonderful day.
We're going to win so much, you may even get tired of winning.
Yay!
You'll say, please, please, it's too much winning. We can't take it anymore.
I feel pretty, oh so pretty. I feel pretty and witty and gay.
We have to keep winning. We have to win more. We're going to win more.
So Trump walks out in front of the press and he just slaps them silly. He comes out. Let's just play cut number five.
I think the press has treated me unbelievably unfairly. In fact, when I won, I said, the good thing is now the press finally gets it. Now they'll finally treat me fairly. They got worse. They're worse now than ever. They're loco, but that's okay. I put up with it. Go ahead. I use that word because of the fact that we made a deal with Mexico.
So. I love it. The press is loco. I can say that because we made the deal with Mexico that you said we weren't going to make. He's just bouncing them down the street. So all they want, they don't want to talk about trade. And the funny thing is, Trump is all about trade. This is one of his big, big promises that he was going to rework this stuff, but they don't want to talk about trade. All Kavanaugh, all the time. So just listen to how cool he is talking about this. They ask him about the FBI investigation. Let's cut six.
I think the FBI should do what they have to do to get to the answer. At the same time, just so we all understand, this is our seventh investigation of a man who has really... You know, you look at his life until this happened. What a change he's gone through. What his family's gone through. The trauma for a man that's never had any accusation, he's never had a bad statement about him. I think he was number one in his class at Yale. He was number one in his law school at Yale. And then what he's gone through over the last 3 weeks is incredible. I want the FBI, this is now their seventh investigation. So it's not like they're, you know, just starting. I want them to do a very comprehensive investigation.
They can't lay a glove on him on this. And it's interesting because, you know, he's not always like this. We have to admit this about him. He can get hot-headed, he can, especially when he's attacked. But he has just been, he just looks like he has got this in his pocket. And he just says, you know, yeah, the FBI, let them do what they want. And so they try to shift it. Oh, this is the other thing. They try to shift it to drinking. And that was absolutely hilarious. And he then goes off on the people who are asking for these investigations. Let's play cut number seven.
Now they talk about alcohol. They talk about all of the things that you hear. And frankly, you take a look at, they're bringing up subjects. We would know about this over the last 20 years, 30 years of his career. You know, what happened? They're going back to high school and they're saying he drank a lot one evening in high school. I tell you what, I happen to know some United States senators, one who is on the other side, who's pretty aggressive. I've seen that person in very bad situations. Okay? I've seen that person in very, very bad situations, somewhat compromising. And, you know, I think it's very unfair to bring up things like this. However, whatever the senators want is okay with me.
So listen to the way Trump just played that about the alcohol thing. They're trying to shift it to alcohol. And he says, you want to talk about drinking? You want to talk about drinking? Let's talk about the Senate, drinking in the Senate. I mean, the stories about the drinking in the Senate are incredible. And, you know, he's pulling the rug out from under them because the whole thing was not about drinking. It wasn't about temperament. It was about, did he try to rape a girl when he was 17 years old? That was what it's about. It's all, they're just trying to move the goalpost. That's what it's about. And he's just calling him out. My favorite remark in this whole press conference, when he starts talking about drinking and the fact that he doesn't drink. And this is cut number 11.
I'm not a drinker. I can honestly say I never had a beer in my life. Okay?
Right.
It's one of my only good traits. I don't drink. Whenever they're looking for something good, I say, I never had a glass of alcohol. I've never had alcohol. I've just, you know, for whatever reason. Can you imagine if I had, what a mess I'd be? I'd be the world's worst. But I never drank. I never drank, okay? But I can tell you, I watched that hearing. And I watched a man saying that he did have difficulty as a young man with drink. The one question I didn't ask is, how about the last 20 years? Have you had difficulty the last 20 years? Because nobody said anything bad about him.
How confident do you have to, I mean, and actually, Trump, this is the thing, Trump is talking sense. They're talking about whether he drank in college. They're talking about whether he drank in high school. How about the last 20 years? What's his life been like? I mean, how confident do you have to be as president to say the fact that I don't drink is my only good trait? And can you imagine what a monster I would be if you, you know, just how he just is feeling like he is filling his shoes. I'm sorry, but people don't notice this because a lot of people don't like Trump and they don't notice the way he changes and the way he adapts. I've always said he's a very adaptable guy. He's a guy who learns on the job. He said he would learn on the job and he has. But that is incredible. This is like the press is in absolute hysteria mode. The left, absolute hysteria mode. Jeff Flake gets yelled at in an elevator. He collapses. Trump is like a rock. I mean, I'm serious. This is not normal Trump. I mean, Trump is always a fighter. He's always in there fighting. I'm not saying that. But he's not always just this confident and cool about the whole thing. He does not seem like he has anything at risk. And when they ask him for more time, you know, they're trying to delay this thing all they want. The FBI thing is nonsense. That whole reason, when Trump was right when he said it's a blessing in disguise because it's called them out. That's why they have to change their tune. But when they ask for more time, he has this great response. It's cut 10.
Tell me about time. Dianne Feinstein knew about this 2 months earlier. If she wanted a really thorough investigation, we had all the time in the world. She didn't have to wait till after the hearing was closed, essentially. She should have said, listen, I have a problem. I have this report. I'd like the FBI to look at it while we're doing the hearings. We had 2 months. No, she didn't do that. She waited till we were closed, and then she probably leaked it, but, you know, who am I to say? But she probably leaked it based on a very bad body language the other day. But more importantly, in a sense, for her to have waited that period of time, and now for you Democrats, and I guess I'm including you too, the media, right? I consider you a part of the Democrat Party. But for you, for the Democrats to be talking about, we want more time for the FBI. If you wanted more time for the FBI, why didn't Dianne Feinstein bring this up?
That is amazing. It's just amazing stuff because you could see the reporters asking the question. I didn't know who it was a lady reporter asking the question. When he said, I just include you with the Democrats, she looked like she kind of went, kind of rippled like he had struck her almost. The guy is in complete control in this press conference. Partly, I'm sure it's because of the victory at NAFTA, which really does redeem a lot of the attacks. It really answers a lot of the attacks on him. But partly it has got to be because he feels he has got this thing wrapped up. And this is part of why I think this Kavanaugh thing is collapsing. They are not going to sell, even the people on the left, who are undecided. They're not going to sell you that, yeah, we said he raped somebody. It's not rape, but he was drinking. I mean, this is what they're reduced to. Yeah, but he did stand near the punch bowl. He was, standing, and he did get he threw some ice at a guy in college. Not going to wash. I just don't think so. And I think that, you know, I take this from the fact that the left is moving the goalposts. The left is now changing the subject, basically, because once this FBI thing started, it was kind of like, I think we got nothing. So they're changing it to temperament, and did he drink in college, and did he throw a piece of ice, and all this stuff. And the fact that Trump has just remained at chill. I mean, chill Trump is not what I'm used to. I think the case against Kavanaugh is falling absolutely to pieces.